Mina, konbanwa, JesusFreakinGamer here. Are you ready for the 30-minute message to actually come on Sunday? Yeah, I know, it's pretty friggin' late in the day. In fact, it's early Monday morning. Pretty typical for me. But I'm actually putting it out, since for me this is Sunday, putting it out on time. So, I'm going to toot my own horn just a little bit there. I shouldn't have to toot my own horn and say, hey, I actually did what I'm supposed to do and I did it on time. Yay! But considering my past track record on YouTube, let's be honest, this is kind of cool. I've messed up, not like every single week, but I've messed up quite a few. I have definitely not had a perfect track record, and that also applies to recently, so a little bit pleased with that. The topic of today's 30-minute message, the long one, not sure how many people are going to watch it, but my hope is that one day, people will pick up interest and people will want to watch some of these things that I recorded over the course of my YouTube channel and the YouTube career, however long that ends up going, whether it's 1 year, 10 years, till the day I die, or get raptured before the Lord, whichever comes first, however that's going to work out, pulling Enoch or Elijah on you. But however long this lasts, be it long or short, hopefully that one day these will minister to someone who needs it. And the topic today is going to be the Omnis. You guys familiar with the Omnis? Even know what the heck I'm talking about? These aren't necessarily just church terms, but you're definitely going to hear them used in church if you go for any length of time. The Omnis are God's Omni attributes. O-M-N-I. And there are three Omnis. There are many, many more attributes that God has. But the Omnis are focused on, there are three of them quite frequently, and that is omniscience, omnipotence, and omnipresence. Omnipotence, omniscience, and omnipresence. The omnipotence of God is his all-powerfulness. It sounds kind of weird when I say it that way, but I'm pretty sure that's a word, all-powerfulness. He is all-powerful. He can do anything. There is his omniscience. He knows everything. There is not a single thing in existence that he does not know. And then there is omnipresence. He is present everywhere. Not so much that he just sees everything and hears everything, but he's actually present everywhere in existence. And those are talked about, maybe not frequently in church, but again, if you go to church with any length of time, you're most definitely going to hear these things referenced. I want to say the reason they're not talked about a ton is because they're kind of just assumed. It's like once you become a Christian, once you accept the Christian God, you accept, you know, he's the one true God, there are no other gods, and there are absolutely no limits to any of his powers, to any of his being. There's nothing he cannot do. And that's more or less the omnipotence side, but that extends into other facets. In fact, the three kind of roll over and spill into one another, because it's like if you are everywhere, aren't you going to, by default, know everything? And if there's nothing you can't do, doesn't that mean you have to know how to do that something or other that you're doing? So you're going to get a lot of overlap. You're going to hear a lot of things get repeated. And I mean, I don't personally have anything wrong with that. I don't find any fault in that. It's good reinforcement. If you hear something multiple times, you're a lot more likely to remember it. And if a certain concept is repeated or juxtaposed with other concepts and you have a bunch of things mixed together, you're going to hear multiple points, and the points that are repeated are points you're going to hear over and over again. So if the three are kind of like all muxed together, then you're more than likely to remember all three of them. And if remembering the Omnis sounds a bit weird, another way to put it is all-knowing, all-powerful, and everywhere present. I guess you could say all-present, so all-knowing, all-powerful, and all-present, which essentially means the exact same thing as omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. My apologies for the uhs and the ahems. At this time, I'm a little bit tired, and my sinuses seem to want to drain a little bit. So I do apologize for those for the duration of this video. And I wanted to provide some scriptures to go with these things. A lot of the times, like I said earlier, these things are assumed when you go into church. They're not necessarily justified by any scripture. They're not necessarily taught by any scripture. It's just kind of like, okay, you're going to church. This is the God you worship. And I'm not sure how wise that is in America. It's still a very Christian nation, and the concept of God, if you speak to someone, even a non-believer, in regards to who God is, the Christian concept of God, this all being, that the three alls that I just mentioned, they're just kind of assumed when you speak of God, at least when I've spoken to people here in America. Even around the world, a lot of people are familiar and have heard of the Christian God, which is great, which is awesome, which means the church, while being as imperfect and as flawed as ever, we've done some of our job correctly, even in the very, very non-Christian lands, Middle East being one of them, a lot of the Asian countries being some of them. The teachings of Jesus Christ, they have reached some ears, and the ideas of the Christian God and of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, apparently those doctrines have hit the ears, even in countries where, by and large, they don't tend to be Christian or they don't tend to accept him. You still find him there. But the who God is, because those they may have heard of God, they may have heard of Jesus. Well, they've definitely heard of God, the being God. But the Christian God, my God, our God, the church's God, Jesus, they may not necessarily know who he is, what he's about, the things that he stands for, and the things that he does. So I think sometimes it's good to look on these attributes, to look on who God is, and not just assume them, not just talk about how great and wonderful he is, even though he is, and a lot of tonight is going to be me just kind of marveling at God. I want to get some scriptures in, and I want to say, hey, this is who God is. Yeah, what the church has said is right, but here's the Bible to back it up. Here is why these traditions, these ideas, these theologies have been passed down to us through the centuries. Here is why we think the things we think about God. And I don't think I'm going to get to all three. In fact, the intent and purpose of this 30 minutes is to focus on one specifically, and that is his omniscience. His all-knowingness. And let's hop right into some scriptures here, because I believe if you're going to establish any doctrine of God or any idea of what reality is, it should be, you're going to want to do it based on this word right here. So, especially if you are a Christian, it's kind of important that you do what you do based on the Word of God. So the first up is going to be 1 Samuel 2:3. 1 Samuel 2:3. This is Hannah speaking after she heard that God had heard her request and that she would be with child, and the child she eventually gave birth to was Samuel, the, if not the author, the topic of the book of Samuel. And in verse 3, she says in her prayer to God in thanksgiving, "Talk no more so very proudly. Let no arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is the God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed." So by him actions are weighed speaks of like his justice and his goodness and the fact that what he does is good and right, and he is the judge. He basically says what is right and what's wrong, and how should these actions, you know, be judged? How should a reward or a punishment for them be meted out? That's up to him. And before that, he is the Lord God of knowledge. That's kind of general and it's kind of vague, but it's a start. The Lord is the God of knowledge. Gee whiz, I didn't think I'd be yawning this much. I think it's the fact that I'm talking so much. So once again, and for the last time, I do apologize. From this point on, I'll simply go forward and I will power through. I don't plan on falling asleep midway through my message. I know some people might fall asleep midway through the message. I will not be one of them, doggone it. So let's go back. So we just covered that he's the God of knowledge. Let's from there go to good old Genesis 1:1. For those that are uninitiated, that's the very first chapter, very first book, and very first verse of the Bible. So go back to the beginning with me. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And stop right there. Now, that doesn't speak of any of the omni attributes right there off the bat. It just says he created the heavens and the earth. Plain and simple. Well, what I would like to draw from that is, if he created the heavens and the earth, one, he had the power to do so. I think if anything, that verse speaks of his omnipotence the most. It's the most obvious of the omnis that's talked about there. He had enough power to create everything that there is. This world, the galaxy that this world is in, the universe that this galaxy is in, our God created all of that. And while that doesn't necessarily speak of omnipotence, in other words, you can create this universe, this reality, but can you really do anything? It doesn't grant, that verse alone doesn't prove omnipotence. I will admit to that. However, at the exact same time, any God who's powerful enough to create literally everything that we know exists, that God is more than big enough to deal with any atheist or agnostic out there. And a God that big is also far bigger than the gods of the polytheistic religions, where one God takes care of one thing, one goddess takes care of another thing. In Judaism and in Christianity, we have, because the Old Testament, we Christians, we share that with the Jews, we have one God who did it all. So he's far bigger than any of the other gods and goddesses spoken of in occultic or pagan or heathen faiths and religions. Any polytheistic religion, just by, not necessarily, like, of course, if Christianity is wrong and that polytheistic religion is true, then, well, that's the truth and I'm wrong. However, in concept alone, the Christian concept and the Jewish concept of God beats out the polytheistic gods by a very long shot. We have a God that can, that's literally created everything. And he literally knows everything, and he's everywhere, and he is eternal. All of these characteristics and attributes of God. The concept of the Jewish and Christian God is much, much higher than that of any other God of pretty much any other religion except for Islam, who also teaches, to the best of my knowledge, the omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent God. There's one God who did it all. So monotheism in concept, monotheism in concept defeats any polytheistic religion. Concept alone. But also, God created the heavens and the earth. If he had the power to do it, he also had the knowledge to do it. Like the concept of human beings, the concept of flesh and blood that flows through our veins, and the hair that grows on our flesh, the appendages like arms, legs, nose, ears, eyes that come out of the human body, the ground which we stand upon, the air that we breathe, the space that we walk upon, the food that we eat, the water and various other beverages that we drink, the universe that we are able to observe. All of these things were concepts, ideas of the God who had the power to create it all. So, not only did he create everything and have the power to do it, he's the one who imagined it. He's the one who thought it up. He was the one who had the original plan and concept. If there was an original artist with a concept board and a planning board, God was the one who did that. He's the one who thought it all up and then implemented it with his power. So, again, that may not necessarily prove he knows everything, but if he created it all, once again, that level of knowledge, it's like, well, what if there are other universes and other things out there? Well, then I would refer to the verse that speaks of God having created everything that is here. I wish I had an editing software so I could edit out the yawns, but unfortunately, I still don't have one, so this will have to do. And if I was preaching this on a Sunday morning, in front of a live audience, I certainly could have edited out the yawns. It would simply be what it is. So this is simply going to be what it is. Now, I'm saying it. I'm not apologizing for it. I said I won't apologize again, and I'm not apologizing. I'm contemplating. Thank you very much. So, any guy, it may not necessarily prove that he knows everything. Like, what if there's a universe outside of this? Well, one, if there is anything outside of this, we know that God created everything. He created the heavens and the earth. He created everything that's in the sea. All that in them is. God created everything. That is, I'll say, and hold on, I think I might know that verse. I think that actually came from the Ten Commandments in Exodus chapter 20. I was thinking of verse 4, you should not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. So he created everything that is in the air, that's in the sea, and all that in them is. Google that one, since I didn't prepare that one in advance and it's not down here. Google that one and see if that what I quoted was right or wrong and where it is. And if somehow all of existence isn't enough to prove that he has an infinite amount of power and an infinite amount of knowledge, if he is limited to the power that created this universe and the knowledge that created this universe, again, that is so vastly superior to any polytheistic or pagan concept. And it is certainly enough to deal with any atheist or agnostic that this God may run across. He's very, very, very big. Very, very, very smart. As far as human beings are concerned, he might as well be limitless in those attributes. He has a lot to offer in the power and the knowledge department. To give a few more verses, Proverbs 15:3. Let me flip over to there. Times like this, I'm kind of glad I haven't bookmarked everything, but I'm kind of glad I can flip to these things with relative ease and swiftness. I'm glad I know my Bible pretty decently. As someone who wants to preach the Word of God, that's an important skill to have. So Proverbs 15:3, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. The eyes of the Lord are in every place. So there's nothing, essentially, that he can't see. And that also speaks of his moral sense. He knows what is evil and what is good. He has a definition for everything. And he can define every action, thought, and word as good and as evil. Another verse that I prepared in advance was 2 Chronicles 16:9. I feel like I covered this several weeks, maybe not several, but like a few weeks ago. I feel like this was one of the points in the verse, or at least if it wasn't the main point of the verse, then I at least talked about it and spoke of it. So Proverbs 16, verse 9. This is when, unfortunately, Asa, the king of Judah, was being a little bit rebellious and doing a few dumb things. The Lord had to rebuke him. And in the middle of that, in 2 Chronicles 16:9. Prophet says, "For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him." To and fro throughout the whole earth. Now, the Jews may not have had a concept of what the entire earth was. They probably didn't know what exactly the entire earth meant at that time. We have a much better concept nowadays that we have the entire globe mapped. But even regardless of how big their world was or how much they knew, that was all the surface of the earth. One, God knew. And two, the prophet acknowledged whatever the whole earth was, everything that all of mankind knew at that point, that the Lord ran to and fro, his eyes ran to and fro throughout the entire earth. So that also speaks... It's kind of like, is he there or does he simply see it all? That may not be a moot point. I can't see you guys, but even if like we were on like Skype or something and I could see you, that doesn't necessarily mean that I am in the same room with you. So I see a little bit of a difference between seeing and actually being in the place. Although we're going to cover that in just a second. We're also going to get to a verse that talks about that. But his eyes are still roaming to and fro throughout the whole earth, which means he sees it all. And if he sees it, that means he is mentally keeping track of it. And he's looking for people with whom he can show himself strong on behalf of those whose hearts are loyal to him. So He's looking at everything, and he's taking note. He's paying attention, and he knows the people who are trying to serve him, the hearts that are loyal to him. And to follow up that, let's go to Jeremiah 23:23. Jeremiah 23:23. Am I a God near at hand, says the Lord, and not a God afar off? Can anyone hide himself in secret places so I shall not see him, says the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, says the Lord? So, and that speaks a little bit more of the omnipresence. Not only does he see everyone in any secret place, no one can hide from him. Do I not fill heaven and earth? And that speaks more of his presence. He actually fills all of heaven and earth. He not only sees it, he's there. Like where you are right now watching this video, he's right there looking at you. And he's right there with you. And just like here I am on my end, he sees me. I don't see him, but he sees me. And he's here. He's in the room with me right now. When I think about that, that gives me an incredibly warm, fuzzy feeling. Because I like God. So I like the fact that he's here. I like the fact that it's so funny because like he mentions, am I a God near at hand and not a God afar off? It speaks of the distance that God does have. Like, God's not directly with us. Like, again, I can't see him. You don't see this bright light glowing in here. You don't see someone else in the camera with me. So there is a distance, there's a gap between us and God right now. But at the exact same time, he fills heaven and earth. And Solomon also spoke of, you know, this temple that I built, can it really house you? Do you not fill all of the earth and the heaven of heavens? Again, I don't have that particular verse in front of me, so Google that. See if Solomon did or did not say what I just said he said. God is everywhere. And if he's everywhere, he can see everything. And by seeing everything, that means if he can see literally everything, that means he has access to all of knowledge. And then let's go for a really, really popular series of verses. And I'm just going to read this all in one shot, and I'll get to the interpretation after that. And that is going to be Psalm 139, 1 through 10. Whoop, passed it there. Psalm 139, 1 through 10. Psalm 139, for the chief musician, a psalm of David. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my sitting down and my rising up. You understand my thought afar off. You comprehend my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word on my tongue, but behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You have hedged me behind and before, and laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend into heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. It's pretty darn cool. Let's skip down to verse 17. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God, how great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would be more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. So he has a whole lot of thoughts. There are many, many. Not only does he observe everything, but the number of his thoughts are greater than the number of sand on the sea. And of course, these are prophetic sayings from God. So this is God inspiring David to say these things and the prophets to say the things that they're saying. So this is God telling us who he is. And so he's everywhere. We can't get away from him. He knows every word that we speak. He understands every single thought. I'm pretty sure I wrote down somewhere in my notes about God also knowing the hearts of man. Proverbs 15:11. Let's go there before I wrap this up. Oh, come on. Proverbs 15, verse 11. Hell and destruction are before the Lord, so how much more the hearts of the sons of men? So not only does God see everything that exists, and he is everywhere that exists, he also knows every word that we're going to say, and he even knows our very heart. He knows the things that we, like, I can't see into your heart. I only know how you act and how you talk and what you tell me of yourself. God knows your very heart. He knows you. If he knows your very heart, he essentially knows you better than you know yourself. And even though I didn't prepare a verse for this, the reasoning there is, I know, as I've lived through life and as I've gone through things, I've discovered parts of myself that I didn't know were there as certain situations arise and as certain things come up. As I meet certain people and they say and do certain things, I will feel something I've never felt before. I'll think in a way I've never thought before. I'll do something I didn't think I was capable of doing. So, I mean, obviously those things are possible. Obviously those things are inside me. Otherwise, I couldn't say them or think them or do them. So obviously they're there. But I didn't know it. It's surprising to me, like, huh, I didn't know I could do that. I didn't know I felt that way. God knew it. He knew it before I did. He knows my heart. He knows yours. That's amazing. I feel like this has been a giant geek fest of me, like, oh my gosh, look at who God is. How amazing is this God? Well, at the same time, and I focused mostly on his omniscience like I wanted to do, so yay, I mostly stuck to the point. Mostly. But it's been a giant geek fest of who God is, and I don't regret it one bit. I love my God. I love thinking about him. I love talking about him. And even though these are things that I did know, it's good to rehash them and refresh them. And it all came to me earlier today as I was saying, what should the message be? And I was praying about it. And then after I prayed about that, I moved on to other things, and it just occurred to me, like, who God was, how much he knew, how he comprehends things that I can never comprehend. And he thinks about things that I have never thought about. Like, he knows everything that I'm going to do, everything that I could have done, and he knows all the potential outcomes for all the things that could have been and weren't. And yet he also knows my exact future. He knows exactly what's going to happen. He knows the actual outcomes and the actual choices and the actual words that I'll take. And it just blew me away to think about that. And I was like, you know, that's the message today. And he knows, like I said earlier, he knows my heart, he knows your heart. He's right where I am, he's right where you are. And to some of you, the fact that God knows everything about you, that is terrifying. Because if he knows everything, that means he knows those things that not even your family knows, not even your best friends know. Those things that if someone else knew, they'd run away from you. They'd drop you in a heartbeat. They want nothing to do with you. At the end of the day, guys, we know we've all messed up. We know we've all done things wrong. Some to greater degrees than others, granted. But we've all done things wrong. We've all done things we're ashamed of. We all have regrets of some kind or another. Even I, who try to live my life without regret, and I purpose to live my life without any regret despite all my mistakes, the reason I'm able to do that is because I have a God who forgives my sins. I don't have to hold on to those regrets because I have a God who wipes my slate clean. He doesn't always get rid of the consequences, but I know he still loves me. And I know he'll give me a chance to make it right. Or at least he'll give me a chance to keep on going despite that mistake. And a lot of you guys need that second chance. A lot of you guys know that if God really does know everything about you, then you're in trouble. You're in trouble. That's a bad thing as far as you're concerned. The good news is he loves you. He came to this earth in the form of Jesus Christ and he died for you. He wants you to be close to him. And he wants you to draw close to him. He knows everything there is to know about you and he loves you anyway. And that is good news. Won't you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior right now? Won't you stop delaying? Stop putting it off? You don't have to stop thinking about it. But some of you have thought long enough. Some of you have been pondering this for years. Right now, if I can challenge you to do so, this is the moment when the pondering needs to stop. This is the moment when the thinking needs to stop, and you just need to give in and give up and let God be the God who loves you, forgives you, and saves you. If you will, all you need to do is profess that you believe that Jesus died on the cross for you, shedding his blood for your sins, for the forgiveness of your sins, and that he rose again three days later. And if you want a model prayer to follow after, if you can't really think of a way to phrase that or a way to say that, then follow this prayer and pray from your heart. Just say, Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I admit that I've done wrong. I admit that I need you. I believe that you died on the cross, shedding your blood for the forgiveness of my sins, bearing the full weight of my sins. And I believe you rose again from the dead 3 days later, guaranteeing me eternal life. Thank you, Lord, for forgiving me. Thank you, Lord, that eternal life is now mine. Thank you for being my Lord, my God, my Master, and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. And guys, if you prayed that prayer, you are a Christian now. You are of the family of God. You are reconciled with your God. There's no animosity and no enmity between you and him. You're forgiven. Everything's good. Not only does he love you, he's always loved you, but now you can start loving him. You can start loving him just like he loves you. And that's awesome. If I can encourage you, just read this book a little bit every day. The things that I talked about God today, you're going to learn about all that stuff and more if you read this book. It's a great book. Study it every day and get to know your new God. And also, show up a little prayer to him every day. Talk to him. Just a simple, hey God, thanks for the day, or God, today sucks. I hate this. Please help me. Those things are prayers. God hears those and he cares. And even though he knows everything and every word that you're going to say, he still wants you to talk to him. So don't just assume he knows and thus you have to go through the pain. No, talk to him. Tell him what you need. Tell him you need help. Because God moves based on our prayers. He moves in time with us, despite the fact that he knows it all. And he will meet you where you are if you ask him to. Sometimes without asking us, but I'd say 99, that high percentage of the time, I have not encountered his grace until I've asked for it. So there's something very real. Even though he knows it all, there's something very real about praying to him and asking him for those things. Because it's when we start talking to him and when we meet with him that those needs are met. So make sure you pray. He knows it all, but he wants you to come to him with all those things and talk to him. That's very important to him. And also, and finally, find a church home. Find a group of people who believe the same thing that you do about Jesus. It's a huge encouragement and a huge help to faith when you find like-minded people as yourself. And guys, thank you so much for giving me 33 and a half minutes of your time. For those of you who watched this at the end, thank you so much. And whether you watch to the end or not, I love you, and God loves you, and God bless.